Happy Tuesday. It's Sesh Tuesday.
Sesh Tuesday. I got my cheese. I got my Topo Chico.
Topo Chico. A fromage.
Fromage and Topo bueno. Chico. You know what I'm saying? So this is going to be this is a different Sesh for us tonight.
It's a little different. I'm just looking at the comments. Kind of guys are getting progressive. But we think we're in line with what's happening, right?
Yeah, we've been hearing about this album. Have you heard this yet?
No, I have not. I have not heard it at all. And have you heard it?
I've not heard it at all.
So that's the big change in terms of Sesh for us. So it's a little bit of a risk, but Ambrose, I'm a big Ambrose fan, so I don't see this as a big risk at all. But I've been hearing such good things about it that I'm excited. I thought it would be fun too, you know, when I found out that we both haven't heard this yet. Maybe many of our listeners, and you can let us know in the comments if you've already heard it. But this will be kind of a special thing to be experiencing it with you, Adam, and maybe some other folks
for
the first time together.
Yeah, it's going to be fun to listen to something for the first time as a group. Yeah, and I know the band, Sam Harris, is one of my, if not my favorite, pianist of his generation. He's so creative. I think he's just brilliant. So I'm a fan of anything he does. Justin Brown on drums, I know and love. And
Justin's great.
And I don't know.
You've worked with Justin before, haven't you?
I don't think so.
Oh, you haven't? Okay.
Yeah.
But I mean, I was just going to say, Sam Harris, I agree, one of my favorite pianists, and his meditation app and his writing, equally great, right? No?
Wrong guy.
Not the same guy?
That's the wrong guy. Yeah. Harish Raghavan, I don't know the bassist. I don't know much of his work, probably only on other Ambrose stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I'm excited about this, man.
So this record too, it's sort of just to triangulate things, I think how this came about. I know we're always throwing different things around, but one of my daughter who is 20, one of her good friends who's also 20, who's not even a musician, but he's kind of like, he goes to school in New York and really likes jazz. When I saw him the other day at the Soulard, not the Soulard, the Tower Grill Farmer's Market.
Hey.
He said, you know, that's how we roll. He said, oh, have you heard the new Ambrose record? And he's kind of always up on the latest stuff. So I was like, no, but I do want to hear it. So
cool.
Man,
do you know, Ambrose, I was just looking it up. Ambrose is 38 years old. For some reason, I thought he was like 28.
Yeah. I was going to say early 30s, but yeah. So he's no spring chicken, in other words. What you're saying?
No, but this is good. It's good. Yeah. It's good.
He's almost in Adam Maness territory of being the world's oldest millennial. Like
I know, man. Hit me up, Ambrose. Let's do some stuff. All right.
So can I show my special guest real quick?
Yeah.
Okay, which special guest should I bring? Hold on. I've got two special guests.
What do you got? Right.
This is special guest number one.
Hey, Penny.
That's Penny. That's all you know, Penny. And then special guest number two. It's a little heavier, not much. Right there. That's Daisy.
Daisy.
She looks huge. Yeah. She only looks huge compared to Penny.
Yeah, but she's like, what, 20 pounds soaking wet?
No, she's, what is she, 6 pounds? Oh, 15 pounds. The other one's like 3.5 pounds. She's a huge rat, the first one, but yeah.
It's awesome. Awesome. Well, shall we get to it?
Let's do it.
Let's do this.
So call out the names of the tracks. I'm so excited just to be experiencing it all for the first time, the titles, the concept, the music.
Well, and this is
soak it all in.
This is easily the newest album we've ever listened to. This is 2020. This is from early June. This is Ambrose Akinmusire. This is On the Tender Spot of Every Calloused Moment. And the first track is Tide of Hyacinth. Thank you.
Moi, 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 moi awani leo kuku marihu okunga fumote onile abere marihu okunde baba.
There's a little bit. Now that, you know, again, the trend here that we're noticing on all the albums we're listening to are these opening tracks, man. They're a statement. That was a huge statement.
Absolutely. And I'm super intrigued and interested to hear how it's going to unfold, which I think is ultimately the goal of any first track, any first tune in a set, any first statement when you're meeting somebody. Like, so many great conversations in that. So I'm already thinking, personality and conversations and dialogue and narrative. And I love this. And I think that, even just seeing a few comments from you guys, this is very different than anything we've listened to, as it should be, because this is the most recent album. This is this year. This is what's happening now. There's many different things. Like, I always think that the narrative of what an artist or artists in this case want to convey on a document, an album, a record, a recording, a gig, the narrative that we want to bring across to the listener is so much more important than what the style is, what the groove is, what the genre is. And so if we can kind of tap into that, I think Ambrose, I'm really feeling like the lineage through the trumpet, because there's such a Nicholas Payton. I'm hearing Nicholas Payton. I'm hearing Miles Davis, Clifford Brown, and then his thing. But like, that tone is, he has a complete round.
Oh, yeah.
What would you call that? Almost like a... his tone is so steeped in the tradition of jazz trumpet playing that
it's
it
beautiful.
Allows him to. It's beautiful, man. It's just round and full. It harkens back to Louis Armstrong. And so to me, that kind of enables him to be able to go these different places. Also, this first track, a lot of challenges to the listener and push and pull. Like, I'm being pulled, like, the free playing, I think, is very advanced. And then they into a groove, and then they slide into, Sam Harris and Ambrose. We're doing, that kind of counterpoint, very precise line together. It's like, it's almost like an overture in a play, where it's like, these are the different things that are going to happen. This is going to be wild. And then bam, brings you right in there.
And, like all grooves where it kind of takes you a minute to get going, if you can pay attention to the kick drum a little bit, I think you start to feel that pulse. Like, basically Justin Brown was doing like a, the whole time. Like, it almost sounded like it could be free. And at times he certainly was like slipping in and out, but there was this really strong pulse happening underneath that was just super, super interesting. I love Sam Harris's take on all this because he's like a fancy chef who deconstructs a dish. You know what I mean? So like you have like duck a l'orange, but it's not, you know what I mean? It's like, it's got the foam and whatever. Like he's on that level where he takes something that is very familiar and deconstructs it in a way. Like I remember, on his super out solo, there's elements there of stride, things like that have this traditional thing, but he's done in a way that you're just like, what the f- is that? What is happening here? You know, very, very cool.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And you hear that with Sam, and then almost in a different stylistically, but in a similar way, the way Ambrose kind of harkens back to an earlier era of trumpet playing, but really pulls it, like it almost gives him the freedom to be able to play out, you know. I love, everybody's always surprised when they hear me say that because I haven't actually done it a lot, but I love listening to so-called out or free playing.
Me too,
you
man.
Know? And
I have.
To me, that's like the pinnacle of expression. Like when you do.
My vinyl collection, the most complete artist I have collected is Ornette Coleman. And I don't really play music like that. I just love listening to it. And it's funny because earlier today I was reading some interviews with Ambrose, an interview with Nate Shinnan, and about this, and he said he wanted this to be his blues album. And you know, I always think that about like The Shape of Things to Come, those great Ornette albums. Those are great blues albums, and Ornette is playing the blues, you know, in a way that is true to him. And that's what Ambrose kind of mentioned that he wanted this to be, is the blues true to him, you know, and you could hear that. It's very, very, it's very hip.
Yeah, I can't wait to see what's going to happen next. A fat tone, CP Mayer, absolutely.
For sure.
Fat, yeah. Wonderful recording, too. I'm like really drawn in with the piano sound, the bass, everything.
Good.
I think it's very well recorded.
For sure, for sure. All right, let's get to track two. I love the name of this track. Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, yes, yes. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love the organ.
That's a wonderful second track. The direction he went was a little unexpected for me coming off the first one, but I thought it was beautiful. It was it deeply soulful, thick groove, and that little accelerando at the end was brilliant because it was almost like a drone like feel throughout it, and so he, you know, really did a good job just structurally of setting things up for a little bit of a change that sets you up for the next tune. You know, I can't say what a pleasure it is to hear this just in order for the first time. I loved it.
That's beautiful. Yeah, Tortog says, I wonder if that was, if they rehearsed this or just went in and let it happen. Definitely that that accelerando at the end was a landmark that was probably worked out for sure.
Yeah.
Everybody hit it.
Yeah, this
time.
Is, yeah, and I'm already feeling in this recording like modernness and like a presence of today, which I think is so important. We've listened to some amazing albums on these Tuesday nights from different eras, and I think that we have a responsibility as artists to always, no matter what the material we're playing, if it's original, if it's standards, if it's jazz classics, it doesn't matter. Like, when we play music, we have to play in the now. Yeah. Like, that's the biggest hallmark of what jazz music is. And I think Ambrose and the guys with him are really nailing that so far for me. You know, I feel like this is now.
Well, that's the only time we have to play, buddy.
That's
the only
right,
time we're ever
right.
in. We're never
no,
in
but you know,
time.
I know, but you can hear when even really good players are trying to play into it. They're either trying to be modern too hard, or they're trying to play a certain way, or they're trying to place themselves into a certain thing. And I think when you can be open to being a part of the lineage, but being in the now, it's an exciting thing.
Agreed. Let's keep going. Some beautiful music.
Yeah.
This is Cynical Sideliners. Tell me about it.
You know what I'm saying?
Here's what's true. Yeah.
Thank you.
I think I was muted. Yeah, that was Cynical Sideliners, followed by Mr. Roscoe. Zach put in here. Is it raining over there, Pete?
Man, it's raining over here. Woo. I might have to mute here. Yeah, I'm going to go inside to say. It just started coming down. Is it raining by you?
No.
What?
I know. We're only a couple miles away.
Is this loud? Is this too loud? I can mute.
That's all good. Oh, that is much quieter. It's all good. I like it. It's got a good vibe. We're dealing with vibe tonight. I was just saying that in that Nate Shinnon piece, there's a story that Ambrose's first gig that he saw, jazz gig that he saw when he was in high school in Oakland, was at Yoshi's, and it was the Art Ensemble of Chicago, and that would be an incredible introduction to live jazz if you're a teenager and that was what you first saw, you know?
Absolutely. And yeah, so Lester Bowie, of course, Lester Bowie from St. Louis. I actually went to middle school and high school with one of his sons, Bottomless Bowie. And David Hines was my band director for 1 year when I was in high school at U City. David Hines, another trumpet player they came up with, Lester and the whole Art Ensemble of Chicago crew and everything. So big influence from St. Louis for sure.
Yeah, there were some St. Louis folks all up in there. For sure. It's great, man. I'm loving this record so far. It's just a joy to listen to.
Yeah, I'm really enjoying it, man. With the rain here and the atmosphere and the, man, it's incredible. I kind of like the two tracks together. I think we should keep doing that because I love transitions. Like, we haven't talked about that enough in previous weeks because we're always blabbering.
We are blabbing.
And, mostly me. But I think on great recordings, and this record's so fun to kind of feel it unfold, but the transitions between tunes, much as the transition between songs on live gigs.
Yeah.
Like, what is the length? Where does it end? Where does it start? So important.
There's some great subtle orchestration things happening on every single one of these tracks. Some interesting doubles. I don't know if you noticed on the Cynical Sideliners, which is just Rhodes and voice, but the melody was doubled except for a couple of places. Like, the voice was doubled with the Rhodes, the top of the Rhodes, except for a couple places, and it made it stand out even more.
Yeah,
it shows you how powerful that effect is, right? Of doubling. And then at the beginning of Yes, was the pianist, Sam Harris, had the trumpet in the top of his right hand, the bass in the left, the bottom of the left. And then there was another voice in the middle.
Yep.
And that was very effective. That's such a simple orchestration tool that works so, so well. It's almost actually like, it's almost too classic. It's almost a Tin Pan Alley trick.
But used
in this context, it's like you don't consider that at all, but it's really wonderful.
Yeah, no, it's good stuff. Yeah, and I think that the unison to counterpoint to harmony and back and forth, that's been used for centuries, but placed where they're placing it here between the piano and the trumpet, between the Rhodes and the trumpet, it's super effective, And it really brings out, the melodic content in a different way and like highlights it and like flows it back and forth, I think is brilliant.
Agreed. I'm liking too that there's plenty of short tracks on the album. Like, there's a mix of longer and shorter. I like that a lot. I'm the 442s are working on a new album. We have been since June, and I've been on a mission to, for every long song that I have, I write a little 60-second something to kind of accompany it, which is fun to do. But I like
a little balance.
I like that flow. So I'm inspired by some of this.
Is that 442 album, is that going to show up on a Tuesday sesh in the future? I think so.
I mean, that'd be a little bit self-serving, but maybe. We'll see how it goes.
Get the exclusive insider's view on that.
Hey, while we got just a quick break in the action here, why don't you tell folks what's going to happen on Thursday?
Thursday. Oh, yeah, Thursday. So I think, is that here at the Open Studio YouTube?
I believe it is, yeah.
Yeah, we're going to have a little reunion, a little chat, a little hang, maybe a little bit of mini listening sesh with Christian McBride's Inside Straight band.
Weren't you in that band?
I was in that band. I think I'm still in that band.
Aren't you still in that band?
We're in hiatus. We're on hiatus. But yeah, super excited about that. We've been talking about this, and we got everybody lined up. The entire band, Warren Wolf, Steve Wilson, the great, the legendary Steve Wilson,
yeah,
the legendary Carl Allen, and of course the man himself, Christian McBride. So I believe that is 8 o'clock Eastern time right here. And you know, we got a lot of stuff. OpenStudioJazz.com/live. You can see what we're doing. We're always adding stuff. Like, we'll call each other early in the morning, be like, should we do this? So we appreciate you guys joining us, but we got some fun stuff happening this week.
Yeah. Well, let's get back to this this beautiful new album.
Yep.
By Ambrose Akinmusire. On the tender spot of every callous moment, which is a great title.
Oh, we'll
do, let's do these next two in a row. An interlude, get more intense, and reset quiet victories and celebrated defeats.
Nice. What you think, Adam?
Love it, man. That might have been my favorite track so far.
Yeah, I agreed. I love the kind of mid-album, you know. Has that been one of our recurring themes or what? You know, the mid-album vibes.
Man, the flow. The flow of the album is so important.
That's right. Man, I feel like we're going to have a resurgence of, I think we're already hearing it here tonight. I mean, this is our most up-to-date offering of the Sesh. And I think we're going to have a resurgence of the strong, thematic, complete album coming out of this pandemic period. I hope so. I mean, I think that it's always been there, but we kind of drifted, like we were getting into that territory of this is a great track. This is like a couple tracks here. This is a video. This is here. But to sit and listen, first of all, to create, you know, hats off to Ambrose for creating.
For sure.
I mean, we're a little over halfway through now. It could go downhill. So I haven't heard this album, like I said, but so far, you know, my tip of my cap to Ambrose for creating a very strong document from beginning to end that warrants listening in order, not only warrants, but just rewards. That's the kind of listening, that deep listening that we strive to do here.
Agreed. Yeah, this is one of those. Let's keep it moving. We have two shorter tracks in a row, eh? Reset,
yep.
Quiet Victories and Celebrated Defeats, and Moon. The Return amplifies the unity.
Mm.
Thank you.
Yeah. What'd you say, Adam?
That was Reset, Quiet Victories and Celebrated Defeats, and then Moon, The Return Amplifies the Unity. Great stuff, man. The combination of those two in a row was super powerful. Again, the simple orchestration of Reset with the trumpet and the piano doubling some things, and of course the trumpet hanging over, and then into that groove. And holy smoke show, Justin Brown.
Oh, man. Dang. I love that. That drone, that vamp groove, and then it's just percolating, and you know where he's going, and he goes there, and that's great stuff. And this is such a perfect place in the album for that to happen. You know, it's like it's a lift, but it's like a serious thing that's happening.
Yeah, man, so much fun. Let's listen to these next two in a row as well, because one is the first one, 4623, is only 32 seconds long.
Yeah.
And then that's followed by a tune called Roy, which I assume is named for Roy Hargrove.
Yeah, I think it is. And, you know, this is such a – I just wanted a little tip of the cap again for Ambrose's – his intonation and those leaps and that high register.
Oh, man.
Man, that's some – that's – and to play it in the way that he is with a lot of, you know, conviction and soul and restraint all at the same time.
Yeah.
That's not necessarily, I mean, I love you trumpet players, but that's not always your strong suit to be able to combine it in that way. But Ambrose, I mean, it's a lot of humility and passion kind of all intertwined together in a way that only the trumpet can do. And Ambrose, I mean, I've always liked his playing since when I first met him, he was young, but he could play. And I was like, oh yeah, this is a good dude. But like, this is, I'm really starting to see the maturity and the artistry. And I'm very impressed. I always have, I don't mean to say like he's just hit this, but like, I'm really on notice right now.
Yeah. The musicianship for the entire band is at a very, very high level. All those flurries that Sam Harris is playing on the piano, Pete, you know, those are not easy to make them sound as even and as varied as he's doing throughout this whole album, you know, and his whole comping style through this whole thing. I mean, you can't even really call it comping at this point. He's literally just
adding. It's so interactive.
Yeah. It's orchestration. It's living orchestration. Yep. Like he is filling in parts. He's also letting the bass and drums breathe as a rhythm section more than you might initially think he should. But I love his choices here. It's the same kind of thing, right? The maturity is off the charts.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah,
let's check out 4623 and then Roy.
Yeah.
Thank you. Beautiful.
Yeah, yeah.
So cool. I love it. Very much like a hymn, C.P. Merritt. Totally.
And yeah.
Obviously a nod to Roy Hargrove. And as you pointed out here, Peter, some big Royisms as well.
Yeah. Yeah, and I should have, you know, when I said Nicholas Payton influence, Miles, of course, all the way back to Louis Armstrong, you can hear that in Ambrose. Roy, I mean, I should have mentioned him as well, because he's a huge influence. You can hear it even before this track. I would say even maybe perhaps more so than Ambrose's sound, although you can hear the influence of Roy. His band conception, and at times very much his rhythmic conception, like where he lays within the groove. I think not only trumpet players, but just horn players. I mean, everybody. I mean, you know, like, I really see myself as a contemporary, and I was a contemporary of Roy. You know, I mean, we're the same age. He's actually a little older, was a little older than me when, and then I played with him, but he had such a, distinctive attitude about playing within the groove in a certain way. Like, that spirit of Roy. Trumpet players tap into the sound, of course, and that kind of thing. But all of us tapped into that approach to the vibe. I remember he had a tune called The Vibe.
Yeah.
And, you know, and towards the groove that was just, it was so joyous, but so distinctive that it's a real gift that he gave us all.
You should maybe do some ear food up in here sometime.
Ear food would be good. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that. And yeah, there's a bunch of records. The Cuban record. Yeah, man. Yeah. This is about the time of the night where we always start kind of foreshadowing and alluding to possible future sessions,
absolutely,
as we would say.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
All right, let's keep going here. We have,
so I'm super interested in this next track, because I was reading some about Ambrose's attitude and the kind of thought process about the blues, particularly on this record. So this one, I think, is because it's so overt. The title is Blues, right?
Yeah. And these are great titles, by the way. I love the subtitles. Blues, we measure the heart with a fist.
Yeah.
Tells
makes you think before you even hear it.
Yeah. Thank you.
That's the track for me.
Yeah, that was great, man. That was great.
Yeah.
You know what was so cool about that? Was that he was setting us up.
Exactly. When, I was thinking the same thing.
When he came in with that brilliant, clear, bright tone after like 4 minutes of like this muted struggling to get out, that might as well have been like the equivalent of like Cedar Walton building up tension with little jabs and then coming out with a big chordal thing. Like it's the same thing. That's what's so cool about this music is that you know, we can listen to that album like Clifford Brown and Sarah Vaughan. There are a lot of the same principles, but it's completely different. It's completely turned on its head. It's the same. It's different. It's awesome.
I totally agree. And I think that, you know, I hope folks are kind of open to a different kind of storytelling, but the same storytelling. This is all storytelling, you know. It's all like hold back and bam and this. And this is like, this is the blues to me. Yeah, this is not about like, where's the one chord? No, that was blues that he just played. Mm-hmm. And you know, very much, you mentioned earlier Ornette Coleman, that this is where it kind of came full circle to me with, you know, blues and the Oliver Nelson, Blues and the Abstract Truth. I was going to say that. But Ornette Coleman, Shape of Jazz to Come. Yeah. And, you know, boo, like very restrained, yeah, blues-oriented playing. I love it.
Absolutely, yeah. And hats off to Harish Raghavan and Justin Brown, too, the bass and drummer on this. Just holding it down on, you know, in and out. Like we were talking when we were listening to My Funny Valentine about, you know, Ron and Tony coming in and out of all these grooves almost every 25, 30 seconds. And there's a certain similar thing happening here where they're just slipping in and out of the time so effortlessly. Man, that's hard to do in the way they're doing it as well. It's great.
Yeah, and it's funny because Justin, like, I've known him since he was a young dude. I mean, he's still young, but I'm like, so to hear, like, I always think about, I'm always like, it's fun to hear these guys hitting, like, I mean, you can compare him to Tony Williams now. It's almost funny to do that because I remember he was just a young, up-and-coming drummer. But, like, I mean, he was percolating on that. And that was some very advanced structural interjections that he put in there to bring about that entire track. And I love it. Great stuff. I mean, it's kind of also like, you know, like, I would say listening to this album, and I would challenge everybody listening now, and this is not about, like, a stylistic thing or do you like it or not. I would just say, like, you have to approach music, this kind of music that doesn't necessarily demand your attention, but it rewards your attention.
Yeah,
like,
sure.
It's like if you go to a party and you meet someone, you know, some people are like, hey, how you doing? Oh, I'm this. You know, they're like really easy to talk to. That's fun. But like you talk to someone else where they ask you a question and kind of look at you and say, well, what do you think about that? They're not like it doesn't demand anything of you, but it invites, like, are you willing to kind of take a step up to the next level, you know, and see what that reveals in your listening and in your interpretation of what the conversation, I mean, because this music is very conversational. I would say if anything strikes me more, I mean, that was like a great, like, modern blues take. I love that. But I mean, there's just a lot of conversations going on. I think Justin is probably the sort of facilitator for that. You know, he's like the one at the party that's like, hey, meet him, meet for her, sure, meet her. This is what's happening, as all great drummers do. And you know, you mentioned Tony Williams, My Funny Valentine. You throw this in that same kind of tradition. But there's a lot of exciting modern conversations going on here.
I think you can throw what Sam Harris is doing in that same Herbie tradition of that same band. You know, there's
absolutely
there's a lot of that coloring going on, you know, painting, you know, the top layer. It's amazing. Yeah. It's amazing, man. You know, I would invite people too who are having maybe, you know, don't listen to a lot of this kind of stuff. And we certainly took a left turn this week, but I love it, man. I think this is what keeps us fresh. And and for me as a listener, this is how I like to listen to music too.
Yeah.
And you know, with music like this, especially music that maybe you don't have a ton of things to hold on to, like references for.
Yeah.
I know, Peter, you and I have both, I'm a fan, so I've heard all of his other albums and listened to them quite a bit. So I was kind of prepared for this, but if you don't have something to hold on to this for, I would say try to listen without too much judgment. Just listen. You don't have to have an opinion.
Absolutely. Yet.
You don't have to form an opinion for years later if you don't want to. You can just listen without judgment and just experience it, and you don't have to like it or dislike it. It's not, you know, it's worth your time to just kind of absorb anything, especially something that is as thoughtful as this. So.
Yeah, and look, I mean, if you listen to it and you don't feel it, no problem. We're not saying, like, this is anything beyond what you have the ability to pull out. It's not like, oh, if you're not feeling it, it's no big thing. There's definitely something here.
Yeah.
But it's not for everyone.
For sure.
You know, but I think that that's so much within the jazz tradition. And you know, if we can lean into the idea of the challenge of the jazz tradition as opposed to just the tradition side of it. It's like, yeah, it's great to listen to the classics. And look, we put up some great classic records from different eras, but this music must move forwards. Like, that's the one thing that we know. It sure. must. It's a living, breathing organism. And 2020 albums need to sound like they're from 2020. And we don't know what 2020 is yet because we're in 2020. And I'm not even talking like
weird.
Pandemic.
We know
2020 is very
weird.
Yeah. But I mean, we can't be like, oh yeah, this is a very modern sound. I mean, like, that's something that you do when you look back at a certain period. But like, you know, the Clifford Brown, Sarah Vaughan, it's like, that was revolutionary at a time. Like, yep. that was like, what are they doing there? And so we need to, and this might not be for everybody, but you got to find something that's happening now. Because jazz is alive, and like, I'm super invigorated and energized, and just texted Ambrose. I was like, dude, loving the album. I'm like, I want to get together with him and just talk about his process. Now I want to find out, like, how did this come about, you know?
Yeah, man. Zune has an interesting comment here. It's definitely a political and social statement. Would you agree? I would say, Zune, that every piece of art is some kind of political or social statement. Even if you're not making one, that is a statement. This of course is, and I think you can kind of, I mean, I think this is almost a statement of, as much about art, even just from the titles he's chose, Cynical Sideliners, Mr. Roscoe, Roy. Yeah. This is about music to me. Yeah. You know, there's a lot about blues. There's a lot about how he thinks about music here. And I think that is a social statement in and of itself.
Absolutely.
Yeah, man. We have one more track. So next week, let's do some kind of Roy Hargrove, Peter.
We're committing to that.
Yeah.
So RH Factor, somebody threw that out there, and I'm like, I love.
I'm down.
I mean, Tenors of Our Time, that's it. Ooh. So that'll be the big mystery, what Roy. But we're definitely doing Roy, man.
For sure.
Love you, Roy.
For sure. So we'll close it out here with the final track, track number 11. Thank you, everybody, for listening this week. We love these sessions. Thanks for going on this journey with us.
Absolutely. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Adam.
Thank you, Peter.
Yeah, man.
This last track is called Hooded Procession. Good night, everybody. We'll go out on this.
Holla, holla.
Later.
Hold on, everyone. I think we lost Adam, but I know how he rolls. He's going to be back. Hold on.
Let's try that again, eh?
There we go. I said we lost Adam, but I know how he rolls. He'll be back.
That road sounds amazing. That was so anticlimactic. Let's try that again, shall we?
You were like, good night. You were kidding around, man.
Good night. See everybody. 15 seconds. Now, this thing has been acting up all night. I don't know what's going on over here on the YouTube, but good night, everybody. Thank you.